Strong, enough to survive a fiery launch. Durable, enough to operate in the hostile environment of space. Powerful, enough to photograph a softball from an orbit hundreds of miles away. Their development is a grand saga of competition, politics, and technology taken to the very limit. Now, satellites on Modern Marvels. Silently, more than 500 of them orbit our Earth.
It's hard to imagine a world where we don't have satellites. It has literally changed the way in which we live since the mid-1960s.
Today's high-tech satellites are some of the most complex machines ever invented. They are the crucial link in an ever-increasing number of tasks, such as weather forecasting, global telephone, fax and television communication, military and commercial reconnaissance, and even navigation. But just over 50 years ago, satellites were simply an idea in the mind of a British scientist famous for his science fiction writing. Arthur C. Clarke was the first man to envision many of the modern applications of satellites. He also penned 2001: A Space Odyssey. And in 1945, 12 years before Sputnik's launch, he wrote an article in Wireless World magazine describing how satellites could be placed in geostationary orbit and used to relay signals. Today, most communication satellites do operate in this orbit, rotating at the same rate as the Earth because of their location, 22,300 miles above the equator. In addition, Clarke foresaw polar orbiting and weather satellites and advocated an orbiting space telescope, which today exists as NASA's Hubble telescope.
So if any person had the most ideas at the earliest time about the modern applications of satellites, Arthur Clarke was the one.
Arthur Clarke was one of a handful of people at that time who had confidence that man-made objects would one day circle the planet. Satellites have to be propelled at very high speeds in order to avoid being pulled back to Earth. For example, the faster a bullet is fired from a rifle, the further it travels before being pulled back to Earth by gravity. But theoretically, if a bullet could be fired at 17,500 miles an hour, it would circle the planet as a satellite. Today, only rockets can propel something at this very high speed, equal to about 5 miles per second.
You have to have a propulsion unit which will take the thing up and put it into a flight path generally parallel to the Earth. Now, of course, gravity is going to try to pull that down. But if you put this at high enough speed, you generate enough centrifugal force that it counteracts the force of gravity trying to pull it down.
In other words, the amount that the satellite is pulled closer to Earth by gravity is canceled by the curvature of the Earth away from the speeding spacecraft. It continually falls around the Earth instead of falling down to the surface. This is the principle that guided Arthur C. Clarke's reasoning. Once a satellite is released from the main rocket, small booster rockets adjust the satellite's orientation to point it towards the correct spot on Earth. And since there is no atmosphere in space to slow the orbiter down, the rockets only need to fire if the satellite slightly deviates from its charted course. However, just because the theory behind turning an object into an Earth satellite seems simple, does not mean we can launch anything we want into orbit. Weight and cost have always been concerns. Some of the first satellites weighed only a few pounds, but still cost millions of dollars to build and send into space. Today, thanks to more powerful rockets, satellites can weigh more than a ton. But launching is still not cheap, at $30,000 per pound. The ultimate extensions of size and weight in satellite technology are the manned space stations where astronauts can live for months at a time while circling the planet. Currently, several countries, including the United States and Russia, are working together to build a new international space station. Yet for much of the world's history in space, cooperation was the furthest thing from the minds of the leaders of these two superpowers. Prosperity and national confidence were running rampant in 1950s America. Dwight Eisenhower, the leader of the Allied army that won World War II, was in the White House. Tail fins, malt shops, and Elvis Presley symbolized the enthusiasm of a new era. American consumers reveled in unparalleled materialism. The Soviet Union was a concern, but America had been first to develop the atom bomb, and most citizens assumed that the U.S. was still the world's technological leader. Until October 4th, 1957, when the Soviet Union launched something they called Sputnik, meaning traveling companion.
My own personal reaction was, gee, that's great. But the general public, of course, raised a hue and cry that we somehow let the Russians get ahead.
The successful operation of Sputnik as the world's first artificial satellite dealt a sledgehammer blow to America's national pride. It was simply a 184-pound test payload containing a radio beacon and a thermometer. The beacon was used to prove that artificial objects in outer space could be tracked from Earth. But even though the technology was fairly simple, its impact was enormous. Many people worried that if the Soviet Union had the rocket technology to launch something into space, there was nothing stopping them from launching nuclear warheads capable of reaching America, an attack which the U.S. could not counter. Yet for all the fear that Sputnik raised, there were actually several positive benefits for the United States.
The Soviets really did us a very big favor by launching Sputnik first, because they eliminated any legal challenge to overflight of territory with a satellite, because they essentially did it themselves, and so they would have a hard time complaining about anything that we did after that.
Millions of dollars began to pour into the coffers of the fledgling U.S. space program. Clearly, America did not enjoy being second best to anyone. The space race was on. At the time of the successful Sputnik launch, the U.S. had already been working for several years on the development of its own satellites. Initially, many people in the government weren't convinced about their usefulness. In fact, before Sputnik was launched, American proponents of space operations were still struggling for respect.
We were considered, frankly, a bunch of crackpots and nuts. One time after I'd given a lecture and had been quoted in a newspaper about military use of satellites for reconnaissance and how you could counter them, this very well-meaning senior man came up to me and said, "You've got to stop talking like that because you are destroying your reputation." Sputnik changed that all overnight.
Surprisingly, we can trace the roots of the American space program back to a cabbage patch in Auburn, Massachusetts. On March 16, 1926, physicist Robert Goddard launched the first liquid-propelled rocket in the world. The liquid oxygen and gasoline-powered cylinder rose a modest 41 feet in the air before returning to his Aunt Effie's field.
His flight in 1926 was a pathbreaker worldwide. Lots of people had understood solid rockets for a long time, Roman candles and things of that nature that we've been familiar with for centuries. But in order to really do space flight, liquid propellants are the key.
Only liquid propellants can be throttled, providing different amounts of thrust at different stages of a rocket's flight. Goddard continued his experiments in Roswell, New Mexico during the 30s and early 40s. Eventually, his rockets achieved altitudes of 1 mile, but his vision went much further. In his early days, Goddard had told a member of the press that a rocket could be built to reach the moon. He was ridiculed in scientific circles and by the man on the street for such a preposterous idea. The wide open spaces of New Mexico provided a haven where he could continue to work on his dream away from the public spotlight. However, because of his death in 1945, he never witnessed an object being launched into outer space. The next major contribution to the American space program came from a very unlikely place, Nazi Germany. Lead scientists Wernher von Braun and about 120 other German scientists and engineers fled from their rocket testing facility in Peenemünde, Germany, and were escorted from Austria back to the United States in the final days of World War II by U.S. Army personnel. Von Braun had been fascinated by rockets from an early age. Now he could use his knowledge to explore space rather than delivering bombs. In fact, during World War II, von Braun had been jailed by the Gestapo for making statements about his desire to work on space travel projects. For the Nazis, anything less than 100% devotion to the V2 superweapon was seen as malicious sabotage. However, since von Braun was so important to the German war effort, he remained in jail for only 2 weeks. The U.S. brought back several of the 29,000-pound V2 rockets that Hitler's army had been using to terrorize Europe during the war. Soon, these former enemies were using their one-time secret weapons to conduct groundbreaking experiments for the American military. However, the propulsion unit initially chosen to power the first U.S. satellite, the 3-pound Vanguard 1, was supplied by the Navy instead of von Braun's team of Army scientists. On December 6, 1957, the Navy got their chance. Dozens of newsreel cameras and hundreds of reporters witnessed the United States' first attempt to catch up in the space race go up in flames. The government gave Wernher von Braun a chance to redeem the sagging space program, and von Braun gave Gordon Veith a sneak peek at the rocket that would make it possible.
Von Braun took me one day down into a shed down at Huntsville, Alabama, at the Army Ballistic Missile Agency. And he showed me a rocket assembly. He said, there it is. When the government says we need a rocket assembly to launch a satellite, that's it. We're ready to go.
Von Braun watched on January 31st, 1958, as the Army tried to launch the first American satellite, Explorer 1, nearly 4 months after Sputnik. The 31-pound Explorer 1 successfully entered orbit and remained in space 8 years longer than Sputnik. After the launch, von Braun declared, "We have firmly established our foothold in space. We will never give it up again." America launched dozens of other scientific Explorer satellites over the next 17 years, most of them under the supervision of the government's newly formed space agency, NASA. Just 8 months after Explorer 1, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration came into being on October 1, 1958. Its official purpose was the peaceful exploration of space. However, its practical goal during this stage of the Cold War was to catch up to and surpass the Soviet Union in the space race. But in 1961, the Soviets upped the ante. On April 12th, the Soviet Union launched a very different type of satellite, one with a man inside. Yuri Gagarin became the first human being in space, and the first person to orbit the Earth. After reaching a maximum height of 203 miles, he landed in a field in the Soviet Union an hour and 48 minutes later, giving the communists another worldwide propaganda victory. After the historic flight, Gagarin said, "I certainly did not feel lonely at all, for I knew that my friends, in fact all the Soviet people, were watching my spaceflight." 10 months later, John Glenn became America's first human satellite.
We're underway.
Godspeed, John Glenn.
On February 20th, 1962, he circled the Earth three times at 17,500 miles an hour.
Roger, zero-G, and I feel fine. Capsule is turning around. Oh, that view is tremendous.
Several days later, Glenn received a hero's welcome during a New York City ticker tape parade.
This has been a great experience for all of us on the program, and for all Americans, I guess, too. And I'm certainly glad to see that pride in our country and its accomplishments are not a thing of the past.
But the United States had finished in second place again, and many people wondered if the country could really meet President John F. Kennedy's challenge.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal, before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
Billions of dollars continued to pour into the U.S. space program. Finally, on July 20th, 1969, with the help of a 363-foot-tall, 6.3 million-pound Saturn V rocket, America finished first.
One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
The U.S. had won the grandest public prize in the space race. And national confidence had been restored. But an even more crucial race continued. Reconnaissance satellites assumed critical importance as the superpowers continued to build their nuclear arsenals. If one side could pinpoint the locations of the other's missiles using satellite photos, then a lethal first strike would be possible. Effective reconnaissance equaled preparedness, and a lack of preparedness could result in complete annihilation. On November 3rd, 1957, Sputnik 2 was the first satellite to carry a passenger, a small dog named Laika. He died after about a week, but proved that life is possible in space. Satellites will continue in a moment on Modern Marvels. While NASA conducted its highly publicized missions, the darker covert side of the space race continued. The American military was working in great secrecy to design reconnaissance satellites to spy on their communist rival. Determining the number of Soviet missiles and the strength and location of its troops was vital information that could prevent the Cold War from spiraling out of control. But developing the technology to take detailed photographs from space was proving to be an extremely difficult challenge. The first attempt was the 1,300-pound Discoverer 1, finally launched on February 28, 1959, after many delays. The government told the public it was a scientific orbiter, but Discoverer was simply a cover name for the CIA spy satellite project codenamed Corona.
Discoverer 1 did not carry a military payload, but it was intended to eventually prove out the technology. It ended up flying into the snow in Antarctica, and we then went on to Discoverer 2, which failed, and 3, which failed, and 4, which failed. And we had continuous failures with these early military satellites until Discoverer 13.
On August 11th, 1960, Discoverer 13 ejected a capsule covered by a heat shield, which plummeted towards Earth. A Navy helicopter recovered it from the Pacific Ocean and quickly flew it to Washington, D.C., where the capsule's prize was presented to President Eisenhower, an American flag. Although Discoverer 13 had proven that an object could be brought back from outer space, top-secret photographs were not recovered until an Air Force plane literally plucked the parachute attached to Discoverer 14's film capsule out of the sky on August 19, 1960.
It returned film of the Soviet Union, and it excited a lot of people within the intelligence community that the day of satellite reconnaissance was here.
Although the CIA won't release altitude figures for modern reconnaissance orbiters, we do know that the Discoverer spy satellites operated in a low Earth elliptical orbit, generally between 100 and 400 miles above the Earth. They flew over the poles in order to take pictures of many different locations as the world rotated underneath their polar path. However, the lag time between when a picture was taken by these early Discoverer satellites and when a CIA analyst could look at the finished photo after the film was recovered, sent back to Washington, D.C. and developed, was about 2 weeks. Hardly instant analysis. But technicians hoped that the new satellite images would at least be an improvement over existing U-2 spy plane photos.
Photo interpreters who were using the U-2 imagery were told to put that imagery aside, and when they got the new film from the satellites, they looked at it and they were rather disappointed. It was not as good a resolution as they expected. And so they actually went back and pulled out their U-2 photography again.
But two events in the early 1960s convinced experts that the long-term success of the military satellite reconnaissance program was crucial. On May 1, 1960, Soviet surface-to-air missiles shot down Air Force pilot Francis Gary Powers' U-2 spy plane 80,000 feet above the Soviet Union. Powers survived. But in October 1962, during the Cuban Missile Crisis, the Soviets shot down another U-2 airplane, and this time the pilot was killed. It was obvious that better satellite images would allow vital information to be gathered without risking more American lives. An indication of America's commitment to space-based surveillance was the establishment in August 1960 of the National Reconnaissance Office. Its very existence was classified, and its job was to spy on the Soviet Union as well as China, Libya, and other countries. In 1962, all of the individual reconnaissance satellite projects in the NRO fell under the general code name of Keyhole. During the 1960s and early 1970s, more efficient satellites containing several film capsules and a more streamlined development and analysis process reduced the delay time to 3 or 4 days. But film was still physically sent back from space in canisters because several experiments to transmit images using radio signals had failed. Two world events proved that a several-day delay was still too long. On August 21, 1968, Soviet troops invaded Czechoslovakia to suppress a pro-democracy movement centered in the capital of Prague. And on October 6, 1973, Egypt and Syria launched a surprise attack on Israel. In both cases, Keyhole satellites did not return photographs until several days after the invasions had occurred. We had wonderful coverage, but we didn't get the photographs until the war was over. On January 20th, 1977, a brisk winter day, Jimmy Carter walked down Pennsylvania Avenue following his inauguration as President of the United States. However, another exciting event was also taking place just a few miles away. That same afternoon, the newest model of Keyhole satellite was able to transmit the first nearly real-time images from outer space to the NRO Processing Center at Fort Belvoir, Virginia. Each dot of the photo or pixel was assigned a number corresponding to white, black, or varying shades of gray. These numbers were converted into a signal and beamed to Earth, where the digital transmission was converted back into a photo. President Carter did not see the images until the next day, but he immediately recognized their value in making critical decisions based on photographic facts instead of the theories of analysts. Keyhole Model 11 had just reduced the lag time for spy satellites from several days to a matter of minutes. But very few people in the government were allowed to see the top secret images from this new Keyhole satellite, also known as KH-11. Even today, only satellite photos taken before 1972 have been declassified and made available to the public. However, this secret information has been prone to leaks over the years. In 1978, William Campiles, a former CIA employee, sold the entire KH-1 manual to the Soviets for $3,000. He received a 40-year prison sentence. Then in 1984, a U.S. naval intelligence analyst leaked this KH-11 image to an English military magazine. It shows the first nuclear-powered Soviet aircraft carrier during construction. Samuel Long Morrison received a 2-year sentence for leaking the photo. Since all modern information and images are still classified, the SPOT commercial photographic satellite developed in France gives us some idea of military satellite reconnaissance capabilities. It is used for a variety of business purposes, including urban planning, crop yield assessments, and environmental issues such as gauging deforestation. Still, the SPOT satellite is not nearly as accurate as military systems. SPOT's resolution capacity is 33 feet, whereas experts believe today's military models may have resolutions of only a few inches. But very few people in the government know the exact resolution numbers.
When you measure resolution, you are actually not measuring the smallest object you are seeing. You measure the smallest distance that you can determine between two objects. You cannot read license plates from a satellite in orbit. They have a resolution that is probably about the equivalent of a softball, about 6 inches. If two objects are about a softball apart, you can tell that from orbit.
New reconnaissance systems even use infrared and ultraviolet sources instead of relying solely on the visible light spectrum. This means that these satellites can still obtain images on cloudy days or even at night. But the research and development devoted to American military satellites has also spawned a new wave of high-tech civilian uses. In fact, one type of satellite routinely saves thousands of lives every year. Some scientists believe that global warming will result in more frequent and more powerful natural disasters in the coming years. In the past, commercial and residential property losses due to tornadoes, floods, and hurricanes have often escalated into the hundreds of millions and sometimes billions of dollars. Yet there is one figure that has been decreasing worldwide over the last few decades: fatalities. Like many other practical forms of technology, America's first weather satellite emerged from a military project.
TIROS-1, which was launched April 1, 1960, grew out of a study that one of the companies had made about the possible use for a reconnaissance satellite. It had a television camera and produced images of clouds.
The images TIROS-1 beamed back to Earth would never have sufficed for military reconnaissance, but the ability to see cloud formations over large regions of the Earth had an immediate impact on weather forecasting and storm warnings. In fact, TIROS-3, launched just 4 years after Sputnik in 1961, identified Hurricane Esther, forming in the Atlantic Ocean more than 2 days before any other means of observation.
if there's a hurricane bearing down on you, or there's a severe storm situation developing in the Midwest where tornadoes are going to be generated, the ability to give warnings that this is going to happen is the first step in saving lives. That's where the weather satellite comes in, particularly strong.
Weather satellites designed to take high-resolution photos and gather precise atmospheric data generally operate in low Earth polar orbits, about 200 to 400 miles high. However, the cloud pictures covering large regions of the Earth that most people are familiar with from weather forecasts are taken from geostationary orbit over 22,000 miles away, the same orbit Arthur C. Clarke advocated in 1945. At this distance, the satellite revolves at the same speed as the Earth rotates, continuously remaining over the same spot on the globe. Before the 1960s, reconnaissance aircraft often couldn't spot hurricanes forming far out in the Atlantic until they were hours away from slamming into Caribbean islands or the southeastern United States. Thanks to the global coverage of weather satellites, people now have days to evacuate. And fewer doubters stay behind to ride it out, since they can see the huge swirling images and hear the accurate data about wind speeds and rainfall amounts on their own TV screens. Today's weather satellites are also capable of much more than taking pictures of clouds. They provide high-resolution images for extremely accurate three-dimensional maps and gather incredibly precise data about global weather systems in the upper atmosphere. They are even equipped with a search and rescue feature for people traveling in remote parts of the world.
In addition to the most common use, which is for boats, it's used for downed aircraft, where if they are in serious trouble, they can activate the radio transmitter and it sends out a radio transmission that is received by the satellite, and that then is relayed to Coast Guard or whoever to launch a search and try to rescue them. And it has been extremely successful. They measure the number of saves in hundreds.
Besides weather satellites, Earth Resources orbiters are also helping researchers learn more about our planet. The Landsat family of satellites take a variety of high-resolution images which can be transformed by computers into 3D animations to assess crop yields, identify fault lines, aid in urban planning, and manage other natural resources such as forests. Because satellites can provide accurate positioning information, a growing number of consumer applications are taking advantage of this technology. The Global Positioning System, or GPS, uses four or more satellites to fix a transmitter's position on the Earth to within a few yards. Such accuracy allows small boats and rental cars to navigate by satellite.
We could pull up a screen in a car and see exactly where we're located and plot the course to where we need to go. I don't know about you, but I get lost all the time, and as my wife always says, I don't want to ask for directions. This enables me to do it without asking anybody else except a satellite.
While man-made orbiters fulfill a variety of functions such as weather forecasting, navigation, or military reconnaissance, they are all, in a sense, communication satellites, because if they cannot send images or data back to Earth, then they are simply pieces of space junk. Coming up, from a crude aluminized balloon to high-tech machines that can handle 120,000 phone calls simultaneously, the extraordinary evolution of communication satellites has rapidly changed our world. Satellites are seen by reflected sunlight. The best time to look for them is early evening. Modern marvels will return. Like scientific, military, and weather satellites, communication satellites also evolved from humble beginnings. In fact, the first communication satellite, Echo 1, launched in 1960, was nothing more than a 100-foot-wide aluminized balloon.
It was a passive satellite that one could point a beam at and bounce a radio beacon off of to someplace else. You could actually see this thing in orbit as it flew over because it was so large and it reflected so nicely.
President Eisenhower listened to a test of his own voice being beamed across the country.
In this first experiment in communication involving the use of the satellite balloon known as Echo, this is one more significant step in the United States program of space.
However, most people realize this was hardly the most effective means of communication. In 1962, AT&T developed Telstar, the world's first commercial satellite. It could actively receive and retransmit signals, but it operated in a low Earth orbit. This meant that it had to be tracked by moving satellite dishes on the ground. If any problem occurred during tracking, the communication link would be lost. In addition, Telstar was only available over the United States for a few minutes at a time before quickly circling the rest of the globe. Then, in 1963, the Hughes Corporation launched the much smaller 150-pound SINCOM-1, the world's first geostationary communication satellite. It could carry only 240 telephone calls at a time. But since SINCOM was over 22,000 miles above the equator, it revolved at the same rate as the Earth, which eliminated both the need for tracking and the problem of intermittent availability.
Even though SINCOM was a relatively lightweight satellite by today's times and used relatively simple technology, it did enable John F. Kennedy to make a telephone call from Washington, D.C. to a ship off the coast of Africa.
This first test proved that Arthur C. Clarke's visionary concept from 1945 worked, and geostationary orbit became the standard location for most communication satellites. Today, more than 150 of these modern marvels operate in this position, serving almost every country on Earth. These pioneering efforts made the formation of Intelsat possible. This is an international organization advocated by President Kennedy, designed to link all the nations of the world by satellite communications. Intelsat 1, also built by Hughes, was launched in 1965. The effort was a great success, and today there are over 20 Intelsat orbiters bringing our world together. Modern communication satellites are made with some of the lightest and strongest materials on Earth.
The graphite epoxy material that we're using in our satellites to keep the weight down is about half the weight of aluminum and 10 times the strength.
In order to keep liquid fuel weights down, solar panels are used to power most of the onboard electronic components. Usually, smaller satellites requiring less solar power are built in a drum shape about 21 feet tall. Larger satellites use expansive solar wings, which are unfolded in orbit, leading to widths of more than 85 feet. Satellites have also dramatically affected our culture by relaying television signals around the globe.
The 1964 Olympics were in Japan, and for the first time using SINCOM, we were able to see the Olympics in the United States transmitted live from Japan. And that brought home loud and clear how important satellite communications could be for television distribution.
Satellite television transmissions in the 1980s allowed the people of the Soviet Union to see how the Western world lived. And today, Chinese citizens also have increasing access to news and information from other parts of the world.
The world will never be the same. There is no longer any remote places in this world because of satellite communications.
Thanks to stronger amplification of television signals by today's satellites, consumers can now receive broadcasts directly on 18-inch wide dishes. As improvements continue, these satellite receivers may become an integral part of most households, providing 400 channels of incoming television and data, as well as one channel of outgoing video. This outgoing channel will make video conferences as easy as phone calls are today. Communication satellites have transformed our world into a global village in less than four decades. Today we can pick up the phone and instantly talk to someone else almost anywhere on the planet. Or turn on our televisions and watch foreign and domestic events unfold before our eyes. International faxing, high-speed modems, and email using phone lines and satellites also allow businesses, researchers, and ordinary people to transmit data around the globe in a matter of seconds.
Real-time worldwide communications was something that didn't exist before the 1960s and the communication satellite revolution that has changed our whole way of life. Our whole society, our economy, is built upon those capabilities.
When American explorer and discoverer satellites were racing against the Soviet Union 40 years ago, no one ever imagined that the space above our planet might become overcrowded. Yet this is a growing concern, since objects in geostationary orbit need to be positioned a certain distance from the Earth and over the equator. They also need to be located about 1,000 miles apart from each other so their signals don't get mixed. Therefore, there are only a certain number of slots left to be occupied, an issue that the United Nations is looking into.
I believe that with good intelligent planning and good coordination by the International Telecommunications Union, there will be enough slots for satellites well into the 21st century.
Another concern as space becomes more crowded is orbital debris, also known as space junk. This consists of various sized objects, such as portions of expended rocket stages, small parts that have come off of spacecraft, and even paint chips. Each dot on this computer animation represents an actual piece of space debris. Many of these items do eventually burn up in Earth's upper atmosphere. But this process can sometimes take decades to happen as their orbits gradually decay. On the surface, something as small as a paint chip may not seem to be much of a concern. But since it is traveling 17,500 miles an hour, it can still have a significant impact. In fact, a speck of paint from a satellite did hit one of the windows of the Challenger space shuttle in 1983, causing a half-centimeter pit. Obviously, a larger object could have disastrous results.
It does exist. It's up there. It's not a major problem, at least at the present. I would be more concerned about meteorites and things of that nature.
Despite these concerns, satellites are bringing our world together at a faster pace than any other form of technology. The term live via satellite used to denote a special world event. However, today the operation of satellites goes largely unnoticed.
The possibility for the future in satellites is almost limitless. Whatever we can conceive, we can probably do.
Because of the visionary work of pioneers who stake their careers and their reputations on an unproven concept, satellites have transformed our world in just 40 years, from 3-pound gadgets, which look more like grapefruits than spacecraft, to incredibly powerful and complex machines weighing thousands of pounds. Considering the remarkably rapid evolution of satellites that we have witnessed in the past four decades, it seems that the only certainty for the next four decades is that satellites will continue to amaze us in ways that we cannot even imagine today.